sits within the Regional Coastal Environment Plan. And for this activity in particular, in this particular gravel extraction area, the Awatoto area, is covered by a particular rule in the plan that is a controlled activity status consent, which the Resource Management Act requires the council doesn't have the ability to decline it. And within the rule in the Regional Coastal Environment Plan, there is one particular condition that has to be met, and that is around an expiry date of 31 May 2017. So the applicant came forward with all the conditions met, being the expiry date, and so the council wasn't in a position to decline the consent. So I guess that's the first point. So we're caught by the policy and the rule as it sits at the moment. But I would go further to make a couple of other comments, and Mr. Rady may want to add to this as well, is that at the time the activity was being considered and the consent was issued, the COMAR report wasn't on the table. That's been a more recent development. Certainly at the time the consent was being looked at and considered, the views of the engineering staff, in particular Gary Claude, was sought, and Gary provided quite detailed commentary on the consent, and Gary's recommendation was to proceed to issue the consent but with an adaptive management set of conditions with the consent. So that in essence means a reasonably comprehensive monitoring program that Winstones have to carry out and do, that our engineering staff review, and then based on the review of that, indicate whether the volumes of gravel extracted either monthly or annually should be altered to deal with any deficit, as you described, that may be occurring. So if there are any adverse conditions, any decline in gravel quantities arising or becoming evident through the monitoring, then council has the ability to scale back the amount of abstraction. And finally, I guess in 2017, it drops into a different category of consent if this activity is sought to be renewed or replaced rather than renewed. It becomes a restricted discretionary activity which the council can decline. And it's probably fair to say that off the back of the COMAR report and other understandings of the coast, is that it's going to be far more problematic for the applicant at that stage to seek to obtain consent successfully. I wouldn't want to say any more than that because I don't want to prejudice the process, but it will certainly be a more problematic issue for them to roll in and get a consent. And more broadly, I think this fits nicely into the discussion that we had earlier. Mr. Rady mentioned the need for a more strategic look at the coastal environment and managing that, because this is all part of that mix, including coastal protection structures, how we're dealing with properties, and how gravel might be managed. So I appreciate that on the face of it, off the back of the COMAR report, it does seem out of sorts with what that's suggesting, but as I say, we're caught by the rule and the plan and the status of the consent, so it meant we've been in a position to decline it.
If I can just summarise then through you, Chair, what you're basically saying is that we had no discretion to return down the applicant, and we have none until 2017. The only mitigation that we might be able to take is if there are some special circumstances that arise between now and then that might give us the opportunity or require us to reconsider the volumes that are being taken or some other aspect of the consent.
That's correct, yes. So it's an adaptive management framework. If effectively, the consent says we'll monitor, or we won't, Winstones will monitor the gravel profile, all of the sort of issues around the gravel, report it, out the engineering staff review it, and then they'll make recommendation to us as to whether we need to change the consent conditions to reduce the volumes of gravel extracted, which we have the ability to do.
Mr. Chair, can I just make one observation here? Seems to me part of the problem is the terminology. Consent seems to apply to the general public that with his consent that there's the ability to say yay or nay. Well, in actual fact, what you're telling us, it's not a consent. In effect, that you have the ability to say yes or no. It's another process entirely.
It is a play on words. It is a consent, so they do require resource consent because it's a legal document. It's just that the Act, in this particular case, given the status of the consent, doesn't give the council the ability to decline it. We certainly have the ability to impose conditions, but you're right. So it is a play on words, and it is in terminology, and it, perhaps ultimately it's about lay people understanding the legislation and how it works, and I guess that's the challenge for us to adequately communicate that so that they do understand it.
Thank you. While you're here, while you're on the job, Councillor Graham, you had a comment, question? No, tyre burning.
So I'm getting harassed by our mate. I note that you're not copied in this latest, through you, Mr. Chair, Mr. Maxwell, you're not copied with the latest correspondence. So I guess this is sort of hotting up as a public issue, and we just need to know where we stand on this. Are we consenting for the tyre burning, recycling, call it what you want, process?
Through you, Mr. Chair. So currently the, I'll back it up. So somebody's sought consent for, I think they call it a pyrolysis plant is the technical term, which is effectively, in lay speak, tyre burning, but a process that is intended to capture the useful elements of, or components of a tyre and recycle them essentially. Part of that application involved us having it independently assessed, so we had a technical person who deals with air quality look at the process and the technical parts of it and give us a sense of what the effects of that activity were. Based on his assessment, the determination was that the effects on air quality were no more than minor, but there would be some adverse effects on neighbouring parties or neighbouring properties potentially. So the consent has been notified, but limited notification process, so parties in the immediate vicinity, and I'm sorry, I don't know exactly who they are, but I can certainly provide that list, have been notified and have been given the opportunity to make submission and be heard should they require. As I understand it, there is one submission in the building at the moment that seeks to be heard, so a hearing is likely for that consent, at which point any of the affected parties can come and make submission to the hearings panel who will ultimately make the determination as to whether to grant or not the consent.
Okay, I'm fine with that answer. I'll leave you with this lovely letter, which of course tells a little different story.
And I have another item here that Chief Executive just brought up, which you'd like to something hot off the press. So.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I apologise for not indicating this morning, but I hadn't received the email or didn't see it till lunchtime. it's an email in regard to, it's called Workshop on Local Government Reform, and it's been sent to all the five councils in the region. It's been initiated by the Mayor of Napier, and it's inviting everyone to a workshop to discuss the information that collectively we want to gather to inform our community in the local government reorganisation proposal. My understanding from the email trail that I'm now reading is so far that's been supported by Napier and Hastings councils, and they're proposing, given the time constraints, that the workshop be held on Wednesday, January the 15th. And probably, I'd have to confirm this, but probably given numbers at the War Memorial Centre, it'll be from 12 till 5. And it's the idea is that it'll it's going to be presented by a company who work with both councils in both Australia and New Zealand to look at council business models. The whole idea of it, and I will forward you the email so that you have as much information as I do, but it's really trying to identify collectively the matters of importance that we can consult on with our community. So we've been invited to this, And I'm conscious of the comment that was made earlier in an earlier discussion by Councillor Barker, I think, about us, you know, perhaps keeping our distance, in a sense, from some of the debate that's going on. So I just really, and I thought, oh, I think I saw this email at lunchtime, so I better come and talk to you about it. So I'm, you know, willing to take guidance from you before you respond about whether or not you wish to participate. So the invitation's going to the council lords, the CEs and the management teams of all five councils. And obviously there will be people who will be unable to attend because it is mid-January. That's pretty much a given. But it was a need to get it done as early as possible if information is going to be collated for the broader Hawke's Bay community to consider.
Whitehall's in as well?
Yes.
Yeah. No, they're already...
They're in?
They've committed.
Okay, right. Okay, right. Sorry. Sorry.
So if you forward that email,
I will
put in the diaries. Very
all
good.
All councils
are invited, and so
three
Nate,
so far.
Napier, Hastings, Wairoa, and potentially us. I just don't know about Central Hawke's Bay. Yeah, I haven't heard.
Okay, right. Well, that brings us to the end of the general meeting. I now ask if someone would be prepared to take us into public excluded to consider some minutes. We have a seconder. What are they?
By the end of the week.
End of the week.
Yeah.
Are you happy to second that we go public excluded? I'll put that motion. All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. Carried. Right, and I had a